Highbridge, a division of Recorded Books, presents Stolen Girls, Survivors of Boko Haram Tell Their Story, by Wolfgang Bauer, translated by Eric Frederick Trump. Read by Bahni Turpin. I become through the thou. As I become I say thou. Martin Buber. The forest that became the symbol of terror in Nigeria is dark and nearly impenetrable. Those who enter never find their way out again. It is said an ancient curse lies upon it. The forest is so old that no one can say anymore what its name originally meant. The Sambisa forest is the last of its kind. Of all the great forests in northeastern Nigeria, only the Sambisa has remained. Its trees do not inspire awe. They are only a few meters high, gnarled and intertwined. The underbrush is full of thorns as sharp as claws. The forest's canopy blocks the sky. The sun rarely filters down to its most interior spaces. The ground here does not offer a firm footing. Great rivers, with sources in the Mandara Mountains, flow not to the sea, but to the Sambisa's swamps. Many predators inhabit the forest. The most dangerous of these are human beings. More precisely, men. The highway that skirts the Sambisa is officially called A13. Gray, craggy rock pillars tower over it, the remains of ancient volcanoes. The highway initially brought progress to northeastern Nigeria. It was finished at the beginning of the 1980s and was the first road to open the region to modern commerce. Its two lanes unspool from Yola in East Nigeria, heading over 350 kilometers north, to near Bama in the northeast. Its asphalt seems to attract people irresistibly, like iron filings to a magnet. Villages, brick houses, and round mud huts crowd along the highway's route. In the past few years, settlements along it have grown ever bigger. They are called Michika, Duhu, Gulak, and Gubla. The road has until recently been a gateway for new ideas. It brought doctors, medicines, and teachers to the people living along its route. Now this same road brings them suffering and sorrow. Glory to God. Our name is Jama'at il-Sunnat li-Dawal Jihad. They call us Boko Haram. Glory to God, we have given up explanations. We have said everything that needs to be said. Some people go so far as to say that we are a cancer, which is an idiotic illness. No, we are not a cancer, and we are not an illness, and we are not capricious people with evil intentions. Even if the general public does not know us, Allah knows everyone. Abubakar Shekau, April 2011. The Forest. Talatu. My name is Jumai, but everyone calls me Talatu because I was born first. Before they carried me off into the forest, I was in the high school in Duhu, in the 9th grade. My favorite subject is math. I like math because it's logical. Once you've understood the logic of a mathematical rule, you can solve every task easily and quickly. Hidden in the swamps of the Sambisa forest are the headquarters of terrorists who, in their cruelty, seem almost without comparison. They are as modern as they are archaic. The world refers to them as Boko Haram, meaning Western education is forbidden. They call themselves Jama'at al-Sunnah li-Dawal Jihad, meaning group of the people of Sunnah for the preaching of Islam and Jihad. They are fighting for the foundation of a caliphate in Nigeria, cooperating with Al-Qaeda in Mali and Algeria. By now, they have sworn allegiance to the so-called Islamic State, ISIS, in Iraq and Syria. In the summer of 2014, Boko Haram occupied a fifth of Nigeria in just a few months. Sadia. You enter the forest, and it gets dark. So dark that you forget it's still daytime. I'm the mother of Talatu. They took us both into the forest. The driver of our truck had to turn on the headlights because suddenly it was so dark. In the West, little notice was paid to the terror that was unfolding in Nigeria, not until what happened the night of April 14, 2014. A Boko Haram commando kidnapped 276 schoolgirls from a boarding school in the small town of Chibok. They forced them into trucks and drove them into the forest from which, at the time of this writing, they have not escaped or been freed. With the abduction of the Chibok girls, the brutality of Boko Haram made international headlines. Suddenly, prominent people such as Michelle Obama, the wife of the American President Barack Obama, demanded, "Bring back our girls." The attack on Chibok gave the intangible a name. It is estimated that by now many thousands of women are captives of Boko Haram. Most are assumed to be held in the Sambisa and its swamps. African and European heads of state organized crisis summits to discuss the rescue of the girls. Angela Merkel, Germany's chancellor, pledged to support a West African strike force. However, the shock of Boko Haram didn't last for long. Northeastern Nigeria is far from the world's political centers of power. In July 2015 and then again in January 2016, I interviewed more than 60 girls and women who had managed to escape from the Boko Haram slave camps. I was accompanied by a photographer and translator. Many women with whom we spoke had just escaped the forest days before. Their narratives shed light on unimaginable crimes and gave a glimpse into the inner workings of a terrorist organization that in the past few years has killed even more people than ISIS. As deadly as Boko Haram is, very little is known about it. It is unclear how it is administered, what its long-term goals are, who finances it, and how it comes to some of its decisions. The interviews with these women do not answer these questions, but they do help us to come a little closer to answering them. Their stories represent not just sources of information about Boko Haram. They are also testimonies about the women. They take us into their lives, which, despite the internet and the effects of globalization, remain alien to us. They take us along the alleys of villages whose names we often cannot pronounce and that are marked on only a few maps. Their stories are painful, in part because they show us how limited our own perspectives still are, how straitened our awareness, and how meager our understanding of the world and the era that we call our own. In seemingly distant Europe and America, the catastrophe that is Boko Haram has not affected us directly so far. Most observers of the situation, however, agree that this group will one day carry out attacks in the West. We cannot ignore Boko Haram's terror. If we refuse to look at the blood spilled by others, we will soon be looking at our own blood. We can begin to confront these terrorists successfully when we listen to their victims, the women. Sadia. They left me only my name. They took everything else. I am now someone else. I feel that. I am now someone I do not know. I grew up in the village of Duhu in the state of Adamawa. Most of the people there are Christians, but we are Muslims. I never went to school. I had to work the fields with my mother. My father was a mason and was always on the go. When he was home, my parents argued all the time. They eventually got divorced. Then I lived with my mother. I was happier as a child than I am today. I wanted for nothing. I miss those easy days. I was married at 16. He was 18. Very handsome. She laughs and looks at the ground. He always played jokes. He was a truck driver and employed at a transport firm in Maiduguri, the capital of the state of Borno. He was in Duhu when his truck had a flat tire. That is how we met. I was standing with friends at a well when he came up to me. "I have never seen you here," he said to me, smiling. That's how it started. We were married 12 years. We moved to Maiduguri and lived on the company grounds of the transport firm. We leased a small store. I sold soap, Maji bouillon cubes, and ketchup. I hired two girls to work as sales assistants. We made a good life for ourselves. He traveled throughout the whole country, all the way to Port Harcourt in the south. Then his truck ended up in a river, and he died. That was 7 years ago. The room where we meet 38-year-old Sadia and her 14-year-old daughter, Talatu, for the first time, is in a small residential building in central Yola, the capital of the Nigerian state of Adamawa. It is mid-July 2015. Both mother and daughter were abducted from their village at the end of August 2014. In June 2015, they fled their captors. We are lying on a rug because Sadia and Talatu are uncomfortable on the sofas and chairs in the room. Where they come from, only dignitaries sit in chairs. The windows are covered with dark cloth. Outside, it is brutally hot. Yola is the last safe outpost before Boko Haram's influence begins. About 340,000 people are said to have lived here in 2010. Yola sprawls out into the surrounding lands, new neighborhoods growing like shrub and grassland. Desperate fugitives come here seeking sanctuary and stability. The encroachment of Boko Haram transformed Yola into a city of more than a million within a few months. From the air, Yola looks provincial. The houses are low to the ground, many still made of brick earth, usually one story, with corrugated tin roofs of blue, red, and yellow. Situated among the houses are open areas where the big markets set up. These are the targets, time and again, of bombings. High walls surround the university and administrative buildings. Only the main transportation axes are asphalted. Dust covers everything. Dust is on the yellow three-wheeled motorbikes that are the inexpensive means of transport for most people. It covers the fleet of used European automobiles that plague the city streets. A few hundred kilometers to the north is where the Sahel, the semi-arid southern border of the Sahara Desert, begins. This region often sends its sandstorms over Yola. When that happens, the Saharan sands darken the sun and taint the air. First a gleaming yellow, then orange, then a dim brown. The sky seems to drape itself over the city. Houses are hurriedly built, wall to wall, and are rarely ever finished because people have usually already moved in when the buildings are just bare masonry and carpentry. People exploit the refugees. The rents are exorbitant. More and more prostitutes are found in this city, where there are many churches and even more mosques. Refugees fill just about every free space between houses, every seam. Whoever can't cling to an existence in Yola, in one of the large encampments, or in the house of a friend, because money runs out, is forced to return to live in one of the outlying villages, where terror still reigns. The women and girls with whom we speak come from these villages. They have returned from a world that journalists are not able to enter. We speak over the course of 2 days with mother and daughter, both confident women. Both were kidnapped by Boko Haram. Sadia is 6 months pregnant. Her belly bulges noticeably. The father of the child she carries is the man who raped her. Sadia is tall, haggard, and fragile. Her voice is deep and raw. When she tells her story, she seems to look enraptured. Her eyes often have no expression. It is Ramadan, the Muslim month of fasting. Sadia is a disciplined observer of the holy month, drinking nothing, praying at the prescribed times. Talatu is not. As if she is trying to provoke her mother, she drinks long and pleasurably, her mother looking away, seemingly hurt by her daughter's behavior. Confidential intermediaries arrange our meetings with the women. After their escape from Boko Haram, they return to their villages. Most of the women with whom we speak are Margi, a small tribe of 250,000 people. We have changed their names in order to protect them. And every day we changed the location where we met them, for even in Yola, Boko Haram kidnaps ever more people. The most recent attack on a market killed 45 people just 2 weeks before our arrival. When we first meet the women, there is much mistrust. We are afraid of them because Boko Haram has been known to force kidnapped girls to become suicide bombers. Almost daily, young women carry out suicide attacks in busy places, most because they were forced to do so. However, others do it out of conviction. Who can measure how much someone will change during a months-long imprisonment, how much the psyche has to adjust to survive? And of course, the women we meet are afraid of us, because at first they cannot tell if we are for or against Boko Haram. For a long time now, they have inhabited a world dominated by Boko Haram. Sadia. My husband was called Musa. After his accident in the truck, he was taken to the hospital, a friend told me. But that's where he died, and I had to give up the store. The store alone did not feed us. We needed his salary. I took inventory of what was left in the store and returned to Duhu. My husband and I had given the store a special name, but I have forgotten it. Strange, isn't it? I have forgotten the name. She concentrates and tries to think of the name for a while, falling quiet. Then she shakes her head. Sadia. But what was I supposed to do? With all my children? I did not know for a long time. I asked the two girls whom I had hired to stay in the store until all the goods were sold. They sent the money to me in Duhu. After 5 months, everything had been sold. I was desperate. I had never gone to school and had not worked the land since my marriage. I tried it again, but it was too difficult for me. My back, it quickly began to hurt, and I had to stop. When you do that kind of work from an early age, your body gets used to it. But I wasn't used to it anymore. So I started cooking kosai, bean cakes fried in palm oil. I obtained a permit from the village chief and set up a stand at the bus stop. She coughs and spits white foam. Her chest burns. She has a headache. She continually puts a hand to her forehead. Sadia. Talatu and I were a team at the kosai stand. She packed the kosai cakes into plastic bags for customers and took their money while I fried new kosai. I always had 12 liters of oil in the giant pan. It is not easy to make kosai. You must be experienced at it. You must know exactly how much of something you must put in and when. I get up every day at 6:30 and wash my children, put on their school uniforms, give them some money, 50 naira, about 20 cents, for a snack. Talatu gets 100 naira so she can take the bus to school. My little ones are named Esta, who's 12, and Buba, a boy, who's 10. I give Buba a soccer ball when he goes to school so he can play with his friends during break. I give Esta knitting things to take along because she likes to knit with her friends. When the children are in school, I go out to the fields to collect firewood for cooking. I need at least an hour to do this. The work is hard, but I like it. You have peace and quiet when you are out there. You don't have to speak a lot. You can think about everything. Then I carry the wood home on my head. I cook jollof rice with onions and tomatoes and potatoes. After cooking, I lie down for an hour until about 2 o'clock in the afternoon when the children come home. They wake me, we eat, and then we leave for the bus stop. I take the giant black skillet with me. Until 11 o'clock at night, Talatu and I sell kosai. I earn the most in December because of the many Christians in the village. In the evenings, I drink a jug of milk to wash down the grime left in my throat from the fire. Then I lie down again. Boko Haram feeds off a part of Nigeria that is among the poorest in the world. Around Lake Chad, whose shores border Niger, Chad, Cameroon, and Nigeria, the majority of the people live, according to the World Bank, on no more than a dollar a day. Nigeria, located between the Sahel and the Atlantic Ocean, is in the grip of powerful forces that are threatening to tear it apart. Here, the Muslims of North Africa and the Christians of the South clash with one another. Few of the world's countries contain such contradictions as Nigeria. It is a conglomeration of 514 ethnic groups and 190 million inhabitants. The North is a religious tectonic zone. In perhaps no other region on earth is the force of religion so palpable as here. This is a zone of constant upheaval. Old values are dissolving. Tribes, though still very important, have lost some of their cohesive force. With the introduction of artificial fertilizers, the population has grown rapidly. The changes in Nigeria are pulling North and South Nigeria further and further apart. The coastal region between the port cities of Lagos and Port Harcourt is the country's economic motor. The oil industry is located here, as well as Nigeria's legendary film industry, Nollywood, which produces more films than India's Bollywood. The wealth that southern Nigeria generates is the reason why its economy is supposed to have surpassed South Africa's in 2014. The south of Nigeria has a significant middle class whose collective gaze is directed at North America. While Nigeria's south is lush and tropical, the north is predominantly sparse. Broad grasslands with solitary acacia trees cover this region. The North has few factories, and most of the ones it had have shut down in the past few years. The people here live for the most part from what they cultivate themselves. However, climate change has resulted in an ever shorter rainy season, making harvests more meager than before. The cattle herds that live off the grassland have grown smaller. The North has hardly any infrastructure. According to Human Rights Watch, only 24% of households have access to electricity, compared with 71% in the Southwest. The people of the North are completely cut off from the economic successes of the South. Northern Nigeria orients itself not toward North America, but toward Saudi Arabia and the Sudan. When British colonists dominated Nigeria, they at first administered two separate colonies, the Southern Nigerian Protectorate and the Northern Nigerian Protectorate. The British were all too familiar with the differences between the two. After Nigerian independence was won in 1960, generals ruled the country for a long time. But since 1998, the country has been considered a democracy. The oil wells in the South have produced much wealth, but even more corruption. Nigeria's politicians have stolen billions from the state coffers. In the northeastern provinces, Boko Haram territory, the Nigerian state, insofar as it is even a presence, is above all perceived as predatory. Nigeria has the highest percentage internationally of children not attending school, with the highest rate in Nigeria being, once again, in the northeast. 70% of the people are not able to read or write. Despite its robust economic growth, the average life expectancy in Nigeria is just 52 years, 19 fewer than the global average. The differences between Nigeria and the rest of the world grow ever larger. In 2010, 61% of the population, 115 million people, lived in absolute poverty. In 2004, the figure was 55%. Although in the Southwest, 59% of the population suffers under bitter poverty, in the North, 76% does. The accelerating forces of the modern world, those of the West and of revolutionary Arabia, pull in different directions. In recent years, northern Nigeria has spawned ever more radical movements. Religious groups have risen up in rapid succession, only to disappear just as quickly. Charismatic preachers flash brilliantly, but in short order fade away. Boko Haram is the most recent and the most pernicious creature that the chaos in Nigeria has brought forth. The weaker the state, the stronger the extremist groups. And rarely has Nigeria been as weak as it is today. What began as a small prayer group has evolved into a powerful army of an estimated 50,000 armed soldiers. More than 7 million displaced people are on the run. Many thousands have been enslaved. According to statements from the Nigerian government, to date, 20,000 people have died. Still, most deaths go uncounted in this conflict. Talatu. I always pack my school bag the evening before. I take my English and math books, the book on agriculture, on integrated science, and an exercise book for lessons in Islam. I always take everything with me, regardless of what classes I have that day. That way I am always on the safe side. I only leave the books I need for Quran study at home, since we only have that on Fridays. I pack a few pens, a red, a blue, and a yellow one. I use the red one when the teacher gives a dictation. With the yellow one, I solve problems. My school bag is small and white and made of cloth. I leave our house for the bus station with two friends from my class. Their names are Rukaya and Maimuna. The school is in Gulak, a long way from my house, but sometimes we want to go by foot, not because we want to save money, but because it's fun. This way we have more time to talk with each other. By foot, it takes us about an hour to get to school. But sometimes we just take a taxi. These are mopeds, always waiting at the side of the road. My school is called Central Bank Secondary School. Every Monday and Friday we have to stand in a row and the teachers check to see if our fingernails are clean and trimmed. They check if our hair is combed and our clothes washed. The teachers are very strict. Despite this, I have always liked my teachers, except for one. He would hit you, and it didn't matter how small your mistake. He was our Quran teacher. Everyone was afraid of him. When he walked the hallway, we would run to our classrooms. The other teachers didn't like him either because he would criticize them for not being strict enough. He'd say, "Don't negotiate with the students. Punish them. Don't engage with them." He hit us with a fan belt. His name was Aliyu Malam. I loved to go on the swing at break or to take the bike on a spin around the courtyard. For us, a bicycle is a special thing. We paid one student 10 naira to ride for a bit on his. Such a feeling. I imagine riding a bike is a little like riding on a real horse. To get home, I usually take a moped taxi. I'm usually tired. At home, my siblings have often eaten everything, so I cook once again just for myself. Then I go with Mama to the bus stop and sell kosai. The best moment of the day is just before I fall asleep. I feel so light. When I'm done with my schooling, I will marry. Not earlier, only after. And then I want to be a doctor. I don't know anyone from my village who has become one. I don't know how I will become a doctor, what school I have to go to. But that is my dream. Sadia. The day Boko Haram came, I awoke at 3 in the morning. It was a Friday. I cooked the rice, brought it to a woman who had a husking machine, and then dried it to sell at the market later on. Every morning after seeing the children off to school, I would bake cakes. Every afternoon, I'd go to the bus station to sell bean cakes until 11 at night. We made a good living this way, even without a man in the family. On this day, when I came home in the afternoon, I was tired. So I lay down on my raffia mat. Talatu. This day I went as usual to school, came home, and took off my uniform. I made rice soup for myself, and then I went over to Grandma's house to fetch some red beans for the soup. She said she saw injured soldiers running through the village. Boko Haram, she said, had already reached Gulak that morning. You have to get to safety, Grandma said. Boko Haram hunts down young girls like you. In the short time Boko Haram has been in existence, it has gone through many metamorphoses. At first, the group was known under the name Yusufiya. This was a small group of Orthodox believers and extremists who rallied around Muhammad Yusuf, a charismatic preacher. He was not an imam who had studied, but a man of the people who could speak like no other. He fulminated against depravity and corruption. Yusuf lived in Maiduguri, a city of mud buildings and sheet metal huts. It's estimated that before the conflict with Boko Haram, 1.7 million people lived there. Today, the population is supposed to be just shy of 3 million. In this city, there are about 5,000 mosques, a handful of these magnificent buildings with proud minarets. Most of Maiduguri's mosques, however, are as simple and humble as buildings in the rest of the city, one story, mud, and usually without windows. Yusuf began to preach at his father-in-law's barn. It is said that in 2000 he broke with the Izala movement, whose full name translates to Society of Removal of Innovation and Reestablishment of the Sunnah. Izala is Nigeria's first Islamic reform movement. Its preachers went from village to village in order to spread the word of Muhammad. Outside the urban centers, people in the north lived according to centuries-old rituals. They were Muslim in name, but they actually prayed to gods of nature. They practiced fertility rituals and rain dances. The Izala movement fought against local traditions, which they wanted to replace uniformly with Sharia, or Islamic law. At first, the Izala imams preached with great zeal and attracted to their ranks many young men who hoped for more freedom and self-determination, especially with respect to their parents. Young people rebelled against their elders. Yet as it became more successful, the movement merged with the ruling class of the North and became softer and more satisfied. Yusuf and his supporters were eager to implement much more radical ideas. Sadia. My little one.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.